Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the first English lecture of this season at the Blavatsky House in The Hague, the Netherlands. Also, welcome to all people watching worldwide via the internet. The program of today is divided into two parts, each of about half an hour. And please interrupt if the things may not be clear to you. After each part, you may ask questions. And in between, there is a break. You may find today information on lectures, literature, and also on courses that we give, also in the English language. And we will end this program today with, at the end, an invocation. That's an appeal to your higher inner faculties, your own inner wisdom. Now let us start off the topic of today. Today we are going to talk about African philosophy, Ubuntu. And for some people, perhaps this is a strange topic because they wonder, will it ever be okay with Africa? Isn't most news from Africa bad news? Today we hope to show that there is no reason for pessimism. The Africans have every opportunity to build a great civilization. The inspiration for this can especially be found in their own culture. And some noble thoughts in that culture are examples that the Western culture can certainly learn from. In Africa, there is often famine, dictatorship, and other discomfort. See all the news in the media. It seems sometimes like a lost continent. But if we study Africa in more depth, there is certainly reason for hope. African history has been mainly written by Europeans. We could call our image of Africa a modern myth created by white people who often felt themselves superior. The name Africa comes from the Phoenicians, and it means colony. Interest in Africa evolved only when workforces were needed for the plantations and the mines in North and South America. With the result, a black page in the history of mankind, slavery and discrimination. Apartheid was only abolished in 1990 in South Africa. The actual African history is largely shrouded in mystery. Fossils show that already 3 million years ago, people lived in the African continent. But there is very little known about it. Only oral traditions, nothing written, and we all only know something more about the old Egyptian civilization. Sub-Saharan Africa, Africa south of the Sahara, is unknown. The peoples who lived there had no scripture. Africa has a huge variety of types of people, only looking at their outside appearance. Long, dark-skinned people like the Maasai, up to dwarfs with light skin colors. There have been constantly migrations on the continent. For example, 500 years AD, the Bantus went from the Sudan to the south. And this had a major influence on the population of almost entire sub-Saharan, this part of Africa. Africa knew in its history some well-organized kingdoms, such as pre-colonial Ethiopia. Since the 4th century, had a very mixed population with the Christian religion. Then Ghana, where is it here? In Central Africa, flourished in the 11th century. Then Dahomey, the present Benin, over here, flourished also in the 11th century. And in the 14th century, the Empire of Mali had its peak. The African civilization was not so primitive as one may think. However, due to the often aggressive influence from the north, both by Muslims and Christians, the African civilization never had the opportunity to develop. Now, the ancient wisdom, known by various names such as the Theosophia, Gupta Vidya, esoteric philosophy, Prajnaparamita, Chokma, and other names, shows that in the evolution of mankind, there are forerunners and laggards. The forerunners are not the great intellectuals that we know, but those who have a greater sense of the fundamental oneness of all life. In every nation, you may find compassionate people who are a living example, also on the African continent. In Swahili, the most important language of Eastern Africa, such a compassionate man is called a malaika. Europeans would translate this word malaika with something like angel. Every nation is inspired by a group of these highly developed beings, known as the Order of Wisdom and Compassion, also in Africa. And this is also evident from the traces of the ancient wisdom in the thousands of stories of the African peoples. And I hope I can show you something of this. Today we want to try to give you more insight into the deeper background of African culture, the relations with the ancient wisdom, and the contemporary philosophy in Africa that is called Ubuntu. The philosophy, Ubuntu, pervades the entire African society. We will deal with this subject by talking about the following key questions this afternoon. First, does Africa have a wisdom tradition? And if so, what is this tradition? Second, what is Ubuntu as a philosophy of life? And furthermore, we will try to seek examples of the application of this Ubuntu philosophy in African society, like, for instance, how does it take shape, Ubuntu, in governance, in politics, in justice, in the economy, and finally we will have a small example of how this all works out in a society like the country of Botswana. Let's go to the first question. Does Africa have a wisdom tradition, and if so, what is this tradition? But before I go into that question, I would like first to have a look at the three fundamental thoughts of the ancient wisdom as we know it all over the world. And the first fundamental thought of this ancient wisdom is the concept of boundlessness, the idea that there is a boundless principle, a boundless life principle, that is the ultimate basis of all life, of everything that exists. About this one principle, nothing concrete can be said because it is boundless. Synonyms for this boundless principle are the All, Allah, the One, Tao, Sunyata, Ein Sof, etc. And it can only be described in terms of negation. In the Tao Te Ching, it is described as follows: the Tao that can be named is not the true Tao. Because the boundless principle is omnipresent. It is every being in its inner core, in its essence. Each being is therefore, in essence, equal to the boundless. And the consequences of this idea are, amongst others, that everything in the cosmos is alive. That means is in the core of its being consciousness. Know that matter exists in this concept. And also that all beings are spiritually connected, are spiritually one. The second fundamental thought is that of cyclic motion. This boundless principle expresses itself in countless sentient beings. All beings are rooted in this principle. They emanate from it and return to it cyclically. And the consequences for man of this concept of cyclic motion are, of course, the process of re-embodiment or reincarnation. And also that this process of re-embodiment is possible because every being is a composite being, consisting of an imperishable part, the spirit, a learning part, the soul, and a transient part, the body. Then there is a third fundamental thought, and that is the fundamental equality and evolution of all beings. This thought follows from the first two fundamental thoughts. All living beings are essentially identical because they are a spark of the one boundless principle. Everything that lives has all possibilities for developing his consciousness. But that doesn't mean that every being has the same level of consciousness at this moment. An animal consciousness is further developed than a plant consciousness, and a man is further developed than an animal. The consequences of this third fundamental thought are that all beings are equivalent but differ in degree of development. There is a continuous evolution of all beings via various countless lives. And also there is a spiritual hierarchy. The wisest inspires less developed beings. This is, in a nutshell, the three fundamental thoughts that you can find everywhere in the world as universal wisdom. Now we go to the first question, and that is, does Africa have a wisdom tradition? And if so, what is this tradition? I already said in my introduction that traces indeed can be found of the ancient wisdom in the wisdom of Africa. And I will give you two examples. According to the different African myths on how the world emerged, came into being, our world and we ourselves are of a divine descent, and therefore, in principle, we are also, in the core of our being, divine. However, the present world is often far from being a paradise. In those myths, it is often told that during the emergence of the world, something went wrong. For instance, the stories of the Dogons of Mali tells us as follows. They imagined the process of the emergence of the world as that motion started in the so-called world egg. And please think about the concept in the Hindu tradition of the egg of Brahma. At first, according to the Dogons of Mali, there were no individual beings and there is no self-awareness, then the first being emerges, Amma. He is the architect who produces in large spirals star clouds. And like a spider, a web produces a web, this is how the cosmos emerges. And this concept of spirals with star clouds can be found in many African myths. And the sons of Amma are called Nomo. And we, according to those myths, are shadows, projections of this Nomo, of these divine beings. And you can find in the ancient wisdom the concept of the so-called Manasaputras, the sons of mind, a similar concept. And during this process, all kinds of things go wrong and make of the earth a school of learning, hard learning, instead of a paradise. And the purpose of the school is to realize by self-guided efforts that man is indeed a divine being. This is all in line with the ancient wisdom, and many African people have similar stories and result in the same image. Then there is a second example of these traces. The Irishman P.G. Bowen, who lived in the beginning of the last century, spent 20 years of his life in Africa. And Bowen, when he was in his 20s, met a wise man called Mela Moya, who was a member of an old brotherhood called Bona Bakulu Abasekemu. And the story tells that this was a brotherhood that dates back from the years of ancient Egypt, from the time of Pharaoh Cheops. And the members of this brotherhood of the higher degrees were also known as those who know. And above them all was the Ancient One. Bowen was, after years of study, allowed to publish some excerpts from an archaic work that was written in Isinza, a very ancient Bantu language. You can find some of these thoughts back in the book Sayings of the Ancient One, a book we have here in our library. And in those fragments you will find sublime wisdoms, and we will compare them with the ancient wisdom. First, so I will now compare what I have just elaborated on the ancient wisdom with the ancient African wisdom. First, you can learn about the concept of Aitonga, which they call in these scriptures the spirit of the tribe. It was the concept of the spirit of the tribe for the ordinary people. However, it had a more profound meaning. It says that the Itonga, the universal spirit, is all that ever was, is, or ever shall be, conceivable or inconceivable. The Itonga is all things are of it, but the sum of all things is not the Itonga. This description resembles very much the idea of the boundlessness of the ancient wisdom, where man is a spark of Itonga, his deepest imperishable part, the spirit. And that is why all beings and all men are spiritually one in Itonga. All beings are connected, and brotherhood is seen as a fact. The second idea in the African ancient wisdom is the concept of cyclic motion of all beings, re-embodiment or reincarnation, and also that man is a composite being with an imperishable part, with a soul called Idlozi, which lives cyclically on earth using a body called Uzimba. And this cyclic process of re-embodiment continues until he has, through a process of learning, become one in his consciousness with Aitonga again. And the third thought is the idea that all beings are equal, but only differ in the stage of inner development. Therefore, there is a natural spiritual hierarchy, and the wisest of the tribe, the chief, inspires the ones who are less developed. This all accurately lines up with the thoughts of the ancient wisdom, which is known all over the world. And there is another trace, because in those writings there is also mentioned that man can not only be seen as a composite being consisting of three parts, but more in detail also as a sevenfold composition. And I will not treat this now, but also there you see a very accurate similarity with the ancient wisdom. I will now go to the next question. What is Ubuntu as a philosophy? Ubuntu is an African philosophy in countries where Bantu languages are being spoken. And the word Bantu consists of the plural preposition ba and the root netu, which means person in Zulu or Xhosa. So Bantu means people. But the word Bantu has become controversial because of the use by the apartheid regime in South Africa as an instrument of apartheid politics. Just to give you an impression of Africa divided on the basis of languages, you see actually that all the Bantu-speaking peoples are south of the Sahara, and then from the Nubian Desert till Cape Good Hope, and from Senegal to Madagascar. It is covering most of those countries. 35% of the people speak Swahili, but there are many other Bantu languages, like in Central and Southeast Africa, Kikuyu, Lingala, and Luganda are spoken. In South Africa, you have Swazi, Xhosa, Sesotho, and other languages, and in West Africa, languages like Ibibio and Abanyom. So many different languages. Now, what is Ubuntu as a philosophy? If you look this up on the Wikipedia, then you find as a description that Ubuntu is generally described as an ethical or humanistic philosophy from Africa that focuses on devotion and relationships between people. There are many other translations of Ubuntu possible, like the idea of oneness, humanity towards others, I am because we are, the title of this presentation of today, becoming human through others. A much used definition of Ubuntu is the belief in a universally shared covenant that connects all of humanity. A wider definition is used by Desmond Tutu. He says that someone with Ubuntu is open to and is accessible to others, dedicates itself to others, does not feel threatened by the talents of others because he or she has enough confidence from knowing that he or she is part of a larger whole and is clinging when others are humiliated or when others are tortured or suppressed. Nelson Mandela said about Ubuntu the following: Ubuntu philosophy is a philosophy of life. Spiritual life force connects the man with his society and nature. The reality is a dynamics of interacting forces. The quest for restoration of harmony and peace in a fragmented world is a crucial purpose. Ubuntu is conciliatory. I now would like to show you a small movie.
Many people regard you as a personification of Ubuntu. What do you understand Ubuntu to be?
In the old days, when we were young, a traveler through a country would stop at a village and he didn't have to ask for food or for water. Once he stops, the people give him food, entertain him. That is one aspect of Ubuntu, but it will have various aspects. Ubuntu does not mean that people should not enrich themselves. The question, therefore, is, are you going to do so in order to enable the community around you to be able to improve? These are the important things in life. And if one can do that, you have done something very important which will be appreciated.
So, you saw Nelson Mandela giving a very simple example that in those days, it was very common that people, when they were traveling around the country, could come at a village, and without having family or friends there, they would be received as if they were part of the community and would be fed, got to drink, a place to rest. And I spoke to an Afro-American friend of mine who had, when he lived still in Africa, the same experience. So this is really the spirit of Ubuntu that you will not find in other countries in the world so often, not here in the West. But Nelson Mandela says it has many other aspects as well. In addition to the presidency of Nelson Mandela, he was also the founder of a group of wise people called the Elders, who were all inspired by this idea, like we find in Ubuntu. And the spirit of Ubuntu is still present in the company of the Elders. The Elders try to be a benevolent force in the world by acting in a proactive way and by mediating in conflicts, such as many years back at the beginning of the conflict in Syria. Until recently, this group was chaired by Kofi Annan, who passed away recently. Then, I also would like to mention the African philosopher Mogobo Ramoze, who has been working and teaching in the Western world and who knows the philosophies of the West, but especially he knows the philosophies of Africa. And he has written a book about Ubuntu. And it can be seen in general that the ideas of Ubuntu are a reflection, a limited reflection, of the ancient wisdom of Africa. Let's try to identify a few of those aspects of the ancient wisdom of Africa which in its turn reflects the universal ancient wisdom of the world. Let's first have a look at the concept of Ubuntu. Ubu means being in general, and Ntu, the concrete manifestation of being in this physical world. And we find very strongly reflected in the concept of Ubuntu the idea of oneness, of being part of a larger whole, such as the community of man where you live and nature. Also the idea of I am because we are, the idea of collectivity. Moto che moto cabato. That's an expression in Soto that means a person is a person through other people. And this means being human is confirming your humanity by acknowledging humanity in others, and based on that, establish human relations. The status of a man in a society is something he or she gains in society on the basis of his or her efforts, and not only because he or she is a human being. The second idea you will find back in Ubuntu is the idea of cyclic motion. Ubuntu means at the same time being and becoming. Motion is for Ubuntu the essence of being. And this is identical to the idea of pantarei of the Greek philosopher Heraclitus, who said, everything is continuously in a stage of development. And the African philosopher Ramoza speaks of the becoming being, if I have translated it correctly into English. Ubuntu considers this motion as a cyclic process where cause and effect succeed each other as links in an endless chain. And the question is, how do you get continuously in a dynamic harmony with other people and with nature? So this idea is really identical to the idea of cyclic motion in the ancient wisdom of Africa. And this cyclic motion, this concept, strongly expresses itself in the African music, dance, and the art. Ubuntu also considers man as a composite being, with a soul and a body, so not with a spirit, soul and a body. That's the difference. The soul is considered as being immortal. Also, reincarnation is not a part of this concept. And Ubuntu has the following view on the various generations of men. First, we have the living man of the present, and we have the men that have passed away, the ancestors, and those who still have to be born. And this view comprises also the idea of honoring the ancestors, like people did in China. And this can be understood if you realize that in all high civilizations of the past, the people showed respect for the former inspirer of the human race. But as time passed, this idea about the inspirer was later misunderstood and transformed into the worship of the ancestors. The third idea of Ubuntu is that all beings are equal. Bato means mutual respect and compassion. Also, evolution of all beings and care of each other and of nature. Solidarity. Spiritual hierarchy. The wisest, the chief of the tribe, inspires the others. And support from the Gotla, the meeting of the tribe. I will tell more about that later on. So, this is, in a nutshell, the comparison of the ancient wisdom, the universal ancient wisdom that you can find all over the world as the core of the teachings of all the great religions and philosophies in the world. The African ancient wisdom, which is identical in the core of its teachings with the ancient wisdom, and Ubuntu, which is derived from the ancient African wisdom. And we will go after the break, have a look at the application in various ways of this Ubuntu philosophy in African society, looking at governance, politics, justice, and economy. And now it is time for you to ask questions or comment on what I have said so far. The floor is yours. Yes?
Is the idea of Ubuntu giving their in schools? Are they children growing up with that thought? Are they the teachers using it in their education?
Well, I think I have not found in my studies that it is part of a certain curriculum in school systems, but it used to be in many countries where the society was organized in a tribal form, and I will explain that a little bit later, because that has especially to do with the governance of countries and tribes, but that this knowledge and being aware of this community thinking was, of course, passed on from parents to childs already, apart from official school systems, because people lived, especially in rural Africa, always in groups, in communities, so that doing things and sharing things together was part of life right from the beginning after birth. So it didn't have to be taught officially in schools because it was part of everyday life. Other questions or remarks? Yes?
The whole concept of Ubuntu reminds me of a lecture that the former leader of the society, Kok, once held about unity, the concept, the universal principle, and where he stated quite simple, in a simple way, how difficult can it be, as I stated in my own words now, how difficult can it be to imagine that we are all people, that we are all human, mm-hmm. and in our humanity we are one.
Yeah.
And from this simple principle that we are all humanity, we are all one, and all human, we may act in the same way in our daily life.
Yeah.
Is this an ascribing way?
Yeah, it is the idea that being conscious of the fact that we are all human and having probably all the same simple goals in life of trying to develop yourself, having your basic things, and also allowing other people to have that would already stimulate very much this awareness of this idea of oneness. So I agree with you that everything underlines this idea of oneness and that it is not a very complex idea, that it you can be aware of it every day if you think just simple about these things.
But
And that's what I felt at the time was the meaning what Cook stated, was that you have to go from the unity or from the humanity of all things.
Yeah.
So everything you meet in life,
yeah,
from this concept of humanity, you can handle, you can evolve,
yeah,
from it and in it.
Yeah. If you start with the idea of oneness, oneness of humanity, then everything that is needed for all members of humanity, there should be enough for it and share it among each other. And that's what you actually want to say, I think. Yeah. Yes? Thank you.
You said that it is, the philosophy is part of the tribes and the rural areas. And how is it in the city? They are growing very much in Africa.
Yeah.
You say about the percentage or
That's
how it is in the cities in Africa.
I think the basic ideas of Ubuntu, the community thinking, to use that word as an important aspect of it, you can find this back also in cities, and also the way, for instance, political parties have organized themselves. But of course, the fundamental idea, just like it was just described, starting from this strict idea of the oneness of all life, the oneness of all humanity, this of course can also be diluted to a certain extent when you don't have a complete awareness of the idea anymore, so that it is maybe the idea still is alive but not so pure anymore. So you find all kinds of variations of that, but you will find it back in various forms, both in rural areas but also in the cities. And just to give you an example, in South Africa, the one of those parties is still organized and has meetings which are based on Ubuntu concepts, like I will later describe the Gotla meetings. And they are a meeting where all members can contribute with their vision on what should be done in the future and how consensus is being built up. So that and that is also applied in big cities like the big cities of South Africa. So there is no real division, I think.
This whole concept all stands or falls with the main thought that we are all humanity. So I can imagine that if this thought is loosened, lost by certain groups as just us, that group forming will be established.
Yeah.
So also here it's, as humans,
yeah,
our duty, I should call, to remind them of this one,
yeah,
fundamental.
True. If the pure concept disappears, then you will get the interests of divided groups, and then the whole concept will be diluted and will not work anymore. And of course that has also happened on the African continent, and that is why you see countries and groups are waging war and so on. But I don't want to stress that too much. You, of course, you can see when the concept disappears or the thought behind it, then you get things you see all over the world. But this afternoon we want to stress and emphasize that the basic thoughts of oneness are there and can be revived again and have been revived, as I will explain after the break.
In my opinion, that concept of Ubuntu is lost in colonial times. Yeah? So
yeah,
there is very few left of these ideas,
yeah? Yeah,
and this behavior.
Yeah. You are right. I mentioned that in the 14th century there were a few kingdoms where they had a lot of this philosophy alive, but then one or two centuries later the whole of Africa was conquered by colonial powers, and these kingdoms or tribes had no longer the possibility to develop themselves based on their own traditions, and they were overrun also as cultures, and they had no possibility to keep this alive or to give it a boost and to develop it further in their society. But now we can see that it is coming up again, and it can be based on the roots of Africa itself, can be a potential development that is there, and that is the own heritage of the African people itself. So that's very valuable to emphasize that, so they can develop their own wisdom further after maybe 5 centuries of delay caused by colonial powers.
Because what you have seen in the history, that we were very heavy fights between tribes. Well, that is not it's not fitting in that Ubuntu philosophy. Yeah. And you got to fight together.
Yeah.
And at the moment you have a lot of corruption in Africa.
Yeah.
Also, that is not Ubuntu ideas. Yeah.
Yeah, I know.
That corruption.
I started my lecture with saying that we all see that picture. But we don't want to emphasize that. We want to emphasize what the potential is for the African people to stand up again and nourish their own tradition. And we will see examples after the break that they have been doing that. I suggest that we now take a break and that we continue after some 15 minutes. And we'll see each other then.
For those who have joined us, I will give a very snappy, brief summary. What we have spoken of before the break is that in the world exists a universal ancient wisdom.
And have traced back that the ancient wisdom of Africa is an exact resemblance of this universal ancient wisdom that can be found all over the world in various names like Theosophia, Prajnaparamita, esoteric philosophy, whatever name you give it. And we have analyzed that Ubuntu is again a derivative, an interpretation of the ancient African wisdom, which is a universal wisdom. And we have done that by distinguishing 3 basic thoughts, and that is, first is the thought of, and I will show it to you by going back to this slide, which we had at the end of the first session, that the idea of Ubuntu is that the idea of the oneness of all life, the oneness of all mankind, but also the oneness of all living beings. Cyclic motion is also something that can be found in all ancient wisdom. And also the third basic idea is that of the fundamental equality and evolution of all beings. These are the basic thoughts for Ubuntu, but also of the universal ancient wisdom. Now we continue after the break by trying to see how this wisdom has been and is being used in African society, although it is not maybe always visible. But I will give you some examples, like, for instance, how Ubuntu takes shape, for instance, in governance. If you look at this Ubuntu, then you see that a very important concept of African society is the concept of the Gotla. It is spelled differently. It is Legotla, it is written. But it means that it is a gathering of a lot of people from the tribe who solve problems together. And I will tell you some more about this. The Gotla is a open communication platform. You see here a picture of in a small village where this Gotla meetings takes place. And it is a dialogue situation where decisions are being made by a whole community. And the adult members of the tribe, of the village, can participate in these meetings. And the aims of this Gotla meeting are to utilize all the talents and the collective wisdom of the whole community, also take decisions on the basis to the maximum of consensus, and also gaining support of the entire community. And summarized, and I do it very briefly, the principles that are essential in this Gotla meetings is that it is based on thinking from unity, from the oneness of society, openness, so people speak out, humility of the individual, and consensus building before taking decisions. The purpose of the Gotla meeting is to solve problems and take decisions, but also to prevent problems, to be proactive. And in Botswana, there is an expression that runs as follows: the dialogue is the best way of waging war. And this is not always what we see on television, but it used to be key thoughts in pre-colonial Africa. Now, a number of principles that are worth to mention about these Gotla meetings are the following. Everyone has the right to attend the Gotla when he is an adult. Everyone is a little bit, let's say, it used to be only the men. It seems that now more and more the women are also involved, but this is according to the tradition. Every vote, when there is a vote, counts. There is confidence by all in the dialogue. There is respect for each other. Storytelling is a means of communicating or transferring ideas to each other. The truth is shared. Everyone listens actively, and there is always, at the end, a decision. It may take days and sometimes weeks, but there is always a decision. And this Gotla meeting has a number of defined roles, like the Gosi, the chief, and he is the leader of the tribe, but he is not just like that, a leader. He is a chief because he is a chief on behalf of the people. So if he is not functioning well, and he doesn't have any longer the consent of the people, he may be disposed of. So it is not an absolute position. When you look at the functioning of this Gotla meetings, then you could actually consider this as the oldest democracies that exist in the world. And to give you also some examples of the skills of the chief, I would like to mention a few of them. That is that he has to listen to everyone, but he should stop endless discussions. He focuses on truth, he asks questions, he senses the environment in combination with a sharp vision. He also creates sufficient time for training all the people who participate in these Gotla meetings. He tries to generate confidence at the work floor or in the community through encouragement and motivation. And he tries to create constantly involvement by all the people. And in the end, he takes decisions and try to keep the community together. Then we have also elder people who are have a certain role because of their life experience and wisdom. And also the oldest of the tribe, who may be have been the chief in former days. Well, this consultation of these gotlas can take days to several weeks, and everyone can share in the ideation and can give his opinion. And if I would compare this way of coming to decisions with what we are used to in Western countries, and I'm now going to give a black and white comparison, but just to give you an idea, so it is a little bit exaggerated, but it is interesting, I think. Then if you compare these two approaches between Ubuntu and the Western approach, then you can see that there is a strong emphasis in Ubuntu on the common interest, the common good. I am because we are together a community, while we in the West are more used to the Descartes idea of I think, so I exist, and are more focused on the individual. Stressing common solutions instead of individual solutions, maximum result for the community, and what we see here in our political systems, tendencies to serve the interest of individuals or certain groups in society, rising above the personal interest instead of seeking for power and influence for oneself or the young group. Social skills are highly developed as a must. In our society, especially technical skills, being very good in the content and how to know the ways of power. Focus on being human and the common good. Focus on oneself and the own group. Everyone is entitled to attend the Gotla meetings. And in our meetings, we have structures and systems where not everyone is invited. So you can see that this system of dialogue and consultation, it takes a lot of time, but then you have also the support and the sharing of responsibility of the whole community. That is, let's say, the in a short sketch, the influence of Ubuntu on governance. Now, how does it affect politics as we define this? In politics, in a number of countries, Ubuntu has played an important role in the decolonization over the past decades. The philosophy of Ubuntu during the last 30 years has played the role of a humanistic-oriented liberation philosophy. The African peoples went back to their own roots with the wisdom from the past before the colonial era, to detach themselves from Western models from colonial times. Ubuntu is seen now in recent history as the basis for the creation of the Republic of South Africa, and is also connected with the idea of an African Renaissance. In politics, Ubuntu is used to emphasize that there should be consensus on major decisions and a clear human ethics so that decisions are aimed at the common interest. And an example, again, I like to mention is Nelson Mandela. As the leader of the liberation movement of the ANC, the African National Congress, Mandela was strongly inspired by Ubuntu after the imprisonment of him at Robben Island. Ubuntu gave him the courage to enter into talks with the white minority government to overcome the system of apartheid. And please note that between his release in 1990 and the first non-racial elections in 1994, South Africa was on the verge of a bloody civil war. However, with patience, Mandela managed to continue his reconciliation strategy and prevent a catastrophe. Until today, his reconciliation policy is still a source of inspiration for solving national and international conflicts. So, to sum it up, Ubuntu and politics, decisions should be focused on the common interest and on consensus building, and there is a big awareness that a clear vision on human ethics should form the basis for this all. Now we go to the next interesting question, and that is how... Yeah?
Can I summarize the whole essence of it in having trust and patience that the universal humanity,
yeah,
Ubuntu itself, will manifest itself through this mutual consideration of
process,
this trust and patience that also forms the basis from the decolonialization, and as you described for Mandela, after he came out of prison, that he had the patience in the trust that it will be all right
at the end. He had confidence that together they would have all the wisdom to take the responsibility for building up society again, taking care of the interests of all, so to speak, and then to do that together and to get support from everyone by having all people involved with this kind of Gotla meetings, so that there would be a good representation of the voice of the people in order to start their new republic.
In theosophical terms, you could say it's trust in the working of karma, of that it by...
I don't know if they have phrased it that way, but you could... I think the key word is self-confidence of a people, that they are able to govern themselves, the country and their future, and to take responsibility for the building up of the nation again on the basis of ethics, principles of equality, and so on.
Unity.
Unity, yeah. Yeah. So the next question is of interest, because we see here, if you really look at the basic principles of Ubuntu, you see that there is a focus on community rights and freedoms and less on the rights and freedoms of the individual. So it is Ubuntu focuses on the interest for groups of people, for communities. And also in justice, you see that what we have here in our Western legal systems is that there is much emphasis on abstract legal principles, while in African justice it is all focused on the concrete situation, what happened, what went wrong, and how can we reconcile the perpetrator and the victim so that again a new harmony will be established. And what also is of interest, especially looking at the details of, for instance, crimes, is that it is very much focused on condemning primarily the crime and not the criminal. And I will give you an example of this. This is the story about the stolen cows. It is in a village that where you have these Gotla meetings, that at a certain moment a man is coming into this Gotla meeting, and he is accused of having stolen a number of cows. And after a big discussion and fact-finding and analysis of the situation, the Gosi, the chief, concludes that the man has stolen cows in order to give food to his family. And so that in this case, it was understood by all the people of the tribe that he had stolen those cows in order to feed his family. So because this was the source of him stealing the cows, they concluded that the goal of the stealing was beyond the own interest of the man. And that is why the Gotla meeting decided to give him 4 cows and a piece of land to be able for this man to feed his family. After 1 year, again, it turned out that this man had stolen cows. Then he's coming back to the Gotla meeting and he has to defend himself again. And then the chief concludes that the man did not make use of the opportunity that was given by the Gotla meeting to better his life and to feed his family with the cattle that was given to him. And then the chief decides that he has to be moved out of the community because he has to protect the rest of the community against this type of negative influences for people who don't take their responsibility, and he places him outside of the community. But it is an example of, let's say, giving a judgment over the act that has taken place, so the stealing of the cows, and not about the perpetrator. And in the first place, he is getting, the judgment is very favorable for the man, and in the second time, when he has not bettered himself, he is moved out. Another example is of the Babemba tribe in South Africa. That is when a person who acted irresponsibly or unjustly is placed in the center of the village in the Gotla meeting. And then everyone gathers around this person in a large circle around this individual. And then each person begins to talk loud to the accused person, one at a time, about all the good things this person has done in the past and how he has contributed in the past to society before he did this unjust act. And this is done to strengthen the self-confidence of the person in order to make him see that he has the ability to write to just behavior so that he can better his life. So that is a very interesting approach that we don't know here in the West. Two examples where the crime is condemned and not the criminal. Another few aspects are that African law is positive in the sense that it is often written that you shall do this and not, as we have written in a lot of our laws, that you shall not do certain things. And that is coming from the idea that that you have to live according to the law and not try to live not according to the law. That is a different touch. And a very important aspect is what I already said, is that there is the focus on compensation of the unjust behavior instead of retaliation, which is very often the focus here in Western country. Here in the West, we have also the system that crimes are time barred, but this is not the case in Africa. It is always reconciliation has no limit in time. Whenever it is still possible to restore the balance, this has to take place. A very big example of how justice has another touch based on Ubuntu compared to Western system is the example of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission of South Africa. After years of negotiation between the ANC, the African National Congress, and the National Party, the South African Truth and Reconciliation Commission was established in May 1995, 5 years after the abolishment of apartheid. And the TRC, as it is abbreviated, was a compromise in which most political parties could find themselves. The choice was prosecution of all apartheid offenders on the one hand, or amnesty for all apartheid crimes. It was the choice between everything or nothing. And since prosecution of all perpetrators was virtually impossible, on the one hand, and on the other hand, amnesty for all was also not desirable, the choice was made for this TRC commission. And the core idea of this truth commission was that it was the principle of amnesty in exchange for truth. And it is really based on the Ubuntu philosophy. It is, you could see it as a mental cleansing process of the entire South African community. And it was as follows, that personal amnesty to an individual was granted only as the person in question revealed the full truth about his or her crimes. And of course, if this crime was, in when it took place, politically motivated, based on the apartheid system. The objectives of the TRC were to sketch a completely as possible picture of human rights violations under the apartheid regime, personal amnesty to criminals on both sides, and restoration of the dignity of the victims by letting victims tell their story and also arrange compensation payments. There were 22,000 applications from victims, and 2,000 people actually told their story in public. Desmond Tutu chaired this TRC, and in October 1998, the first part of the report of TRC came out, and the conclusion was that it condemned apartheid as a crime against humanity, not surprising, of course, and both ANC and the white parties were both found guilty of violating human rights. The South African Truth Commission is seen internationally as a great success and played a key role in the South African democratic transition process that took place after that. So justice is in African tradition mainly aimed at restoring the balance, compensation, instead of retribution. And the Truth and Reconciliation Commission of South Africa is an example of that. Now, another question is, how do we find Ubuntu back in the economy? Again, here the three main principles of the Ubuntu philosophy: unity and collectivity, cyclic motion, motion in society as something that is part of life, and the evolution of all beings. Men have to take care of each other and nature. And you can see that in various expressions that you can find in Ubuntu literature. And one of them is that that expression, moto kimoto kabato, that means, when you translate it freely, that you have to take care of each other and you have to share things. And another expression is that the care for each other and sharing together has priority over the collection and protection of assets in this world. And that also includes the natural environment. So if you think about it logically, then this means that economy means, based on Ubuntu, the pursuit of a sustainable economy. Now, as a final example of application, and I'm not going to explain to you the ideal examples, because that I have not found, but it gives you an impression of the intentions and the potentialities that Ubuntu has for African society. The example of the country of Botswana. The African country of Botswana was named the best performing economy by the magazine The Economist in 2005, thanks, as they mentioned, to the use of Ubuntu and the use of the Gotla meetings, as they called it, the tribal politics. For also in business companies, the dialogue between the employer and employee takes place on the basis of a broad support by the workers, to give also priorities to the interests of all the people who work at a company, to strengthen the we feeling in the company, and also to take care of the development of every worker. At a national level in Botswana, we see that it is a parliamentary republic with several parties since 1966, is headed by a president with a term of 5 years, and there is a legislative power that consists of two chambers. One is based on the tradition of the country, an advisory house of chiefs with 15 seats, in which the tribal chiefs of the largest tribes have their seats. And there is the National Assembly consisting of 47 members, like we have our parliament. The country of Botswana has been a stable democracy since its independence in 1966, never had a coup d'etat or large-scale violence, and no ethnic tensions so far. Botswana is also, from a material point of view, relatively rich, almost the highest income per capita in Africa. And Botswana has been praised by the African Development Bank for sustaining one of the world's longest economic booms. Economic growth since the late 1960s has been comparable with those of some of Asia's largest economies. Primary education is free in Botswana, and the percentage of people living below the poverty line has been reduced from 50 to 19% over the last 40 years. But according to the World Bank, this poverty is still the reason why further development is hampered at the moment. Almost as important, Botswana is on the 31st place of the least corrupt countries in the world. And according to the index, it is the least corrupt country in the African continent. But since the discovery of diamonds in Botswana, also corruption has become really an issue that the country has to take care of in order not to hamper the growth further. So, just a small impression of this country where all the institutions, but also the private companies, have their influence of this Ubuntu philosophy, and that is the reason why everybody considered this country as a stable country, which is really developing in the right direction. I will come now to my summary of this presentation of today. And I will briefly again touch upon all the questions that we have spoken of today. The first question was, does Africa have a wisdom tradition? And if so, what is this tradition? I have tried to analyze and show you that the ancient African wisdom is identical to the universal ancient wisdom, which you can find everywhere on this globe. It has the concept in it of the boundlessness of life. In African wisdom mentioned, Itonga, or the spirit of the tribe, It has the concept of cyclic motion or reincarnation, and also the concept of the fundamental equality and evolution of all beings. And to a certain extent, these elements of the ancient African traditions are echoed and reflected in the Ubuntu philosophy that we know now in present-day Africa. We see that Ubuntu is stressing, emphasizing the collectivity of all life in society, the cyclic motion of everything with the immortal soul as a concept, and a big emphasis on respect, compassion, solidarity, and also the system of spiritual hierarchy that the wisest inspires other people. We have shown some examples how Ubuntu works out in society, in governance, that the common interest plays a major role when it is justly applied in society, and in politics, that everything is focused on the common interest and on consensus building with a clear vision on human ethics, that justice is deviating from the principles that we know in the West, and that's especially the idea of compensation and restoring the balance between people is very important. See the Truth Commission of South Africa, that in basically Ubuntu should pursue a sustainable economy approach, and that in Botswana people are really trying to live up to the ideas of Ubuntu and have been very successful so far. Now, to conclude this presentation on Ubuntu, I would like to give you a small taste of the ancient African wisdom of which I mentioned a book called Sayings of the Ancient One. The Ancient One is a representative of these old, of the group of people who has knowledge which is identical to the ancient wisdom known all over the world, and talks about expressions of a man called the Ancient One, and it runs as follows. The Ancient One said, "He who walks the path of light is marked by compassion, for he understands the needs of the weary animal, the sorrows of the child, and the mind of the stranger. He is marked by harmony of the soul, for his eye perceives nature, his heart comprehends nature, and his courage enables him to dwell with nature. He is marked by skill in action, for he loves his work, he knows his work, and he works with will for no reward. He is marked by a universal vision, for he loves all things, he is just to all beings, and he serves the law with gladness. O my son, when the marks of true manhood are engraved in the substance of your being, you will ask no more for knowledge, nor will you crave to possess it, because you will be knowledge itself. Follow thou after peace." Thank you. The floor is yours. Any questions or remarks? Yeah?
Yeah, with Ubuntu philosophy, then is there a place for political parties? Because we are all together, so how you can make parties that make a difference between people?
Yeah. That's a good remark. Why this division between different parties that are having other goals within a nation? actually when in pre-colonial Africa we could look at how the tribes or the country were governed, then that was via a system of the gotlas, where actually this division of partners was not present, because there was actually one group that would sit together so long that they would reach consensus over decisions to be taken to come to the best solution for the interest of all people. And what we see in countries like our country, where we have various political parties, and also in Africa, they have copied the system after the colonial era, you see that there is a, let's say, division in groups and interest of different groups. And that is basically not the system of Ubuntu, because the system of Ubuntu is that there is one group that is representing the whole of society and where all decision making is taking place. So political parties that are not joining together to form one group and one gotla where all the decisions are taken is not according to Ubuntu.
Then another question is, there are so many conflicts in Western society, so if you want to solve them by sitting together in a group for days or weeks, then there is not enough time to solve all the problems, because
yes,
there are so many conflicts between people, so it's only possible when you have a limited number of conflicts.
But this is seeing what the priorities are, because this system of sitting together and talking until you have reached to a solution or a conclusion based on consensus is something that can be seen in the history of many peoples in the world. For instance, if you look at the example of the Indians of North America, they had also different tribes, and they had in a certain time in their history, they had the same idea, or which I quoted as a quotation from the people from Botswana, that the best way to wage war is by having a dialogue. And they would sit together as tribes for weeks in order to prevent waging war against each other. So this is all a matter of, you know, what is time? What is priorities? What is not having time to solve problems in a fundamental way by talking with each other maybe for days or weeks or maybe months or years in order to prevent a war, a trade war or other conflicts? So this is all changing your own mindset to seeing not the impossibilities of having sufficient time, but seeing the possibilities of seeing that there is enough time if you take a time out in order to discuss things with each other, in order to solve things by coming to a good idea based on consensus that supports the interests of all. So this is all a matter of mindset. Yeah.
It's the consensus lies in the understanding and the beginning of the Bongo itself. There is this humanity. There is this oneness. So what is time?
Yeah.
And then you can come to the solution at the end from consensus must be the answer.
Yeah.
From seen from wisdom from.
Yeah. But the point is that everyone who is part of this whole picture should, of course, support this idea and should be in favor or be sensitive to this idea of oneness and the interconnectedness of all beings that also follows from this concept of oneness, and that you can try to separate yourself from others, but there is always relations and you always have to deal with each other. So it is better to think of ideas that serve the interests of all, so that you can come to a consensus that is serving the interest of all the parties involved.
That's maybe it's better to speak not of consensus, but of a win-win situation.
Yeah, that's maybe a modern way of phrasing it.
Yeah, for the individual as well as for the community itself.
Yeah.
Jo, iedereen in Nederland. Je hebt er in Nederland ook mogelijkheid als je een probleem hebt met echtscheiding of huwelijksruzie voor mediatorschap.
I get a question in Dutch, which I will translate briefly for you. In society, like here in the Netherlands, when you have a problem in your personal relation, you have also the possibility of mediation. That is also, instead of going to court, that's also a way of dealing with, difference in interest, instead of fighting with each other. Yeah? Other questions or remarks? Yeah.
You spoke about the book of Rabosa, right?
Yeah, Rabosa. Yeah.
And I remember a remark, a very interesting remark he made about the word competition. He said the original meaning of this word is if you do it by the etymology.
If you look at the roots of the word in language,
working you is thriving together to get a solution, but together. But now in the Western meaning is opposite.
That's an interesting remark. The African philosopher Ramosa, which I quoted before the break, who wrote a book about Ubuntu, said that. Here in the West, competition is seen as strife and fighting with each other, while the original meaning of the word competition was trying to seek together to a solution that would serve both parties. So that we have chosen for the meaning of the word competition the fighting one, the fighting meaning of it.
Your remark was that the trust of Mandela, it's also based on this idea.
Yeah, to come to a common solution.
Together, yeah.
Mutual
trust and mutual interest, sharing mutual interest. Yeah. So in management literature nowadays, this is also often called the mutual gain approach, that you were. Try to see the benefits which serve all parties. Other questions or remarks? If not, then we are going to conclude this session. And as I announced at the beginning of this meeting, that we are going to finalize our meeting with what we call a invocation that is derived from one of the traditions in India, the writings of the Rig Veda, and it is called the Gayatri, and it is an appeal to our innermost wisdom, and it runs as follows. O thou golden sun of most excellent splendor, illumine our hearts and fill our minds so that we, recognizing our oneness with the divinity which is the heart of the universe, may see the pathway before our feet and tread it to those distant goals of perfection, stimulated by thy own radiant light.